history community, and we differ in opinion on a lot of things, but it's a healthy thing. Okay, so quickly, what this talk is going to go through, it's going to go through stages. I'm just going to introduce what scanners are. Most of you probably already know that, but it's part of the talk. Then I'm going to focus heavily on why scanners don't make you safe. This talk is not about why scanners suck. I don't think they suck, but I think they're highly misunderstood and they have a place. And so now I'm going to talk about that. Then we're going to talk about how scanners work. Things like banners, registry keys, S&P values, inference and detection. I have an obligation to introduce all the freeware tools that I know about. The scanners are very expensive, and if you don't really need an expensive scanner, there are tools out there that are free. And then I'm going to talk about my ideas that I've had about creating a bit better scanner. Oh, sorry, I didn't advance my slide. This is the first talk I've ever given, so you guys have to be easy on it. Security scanners can go out and like check permissions on files, things like that, or registry keys, settings. Alright, so history scanners. Everybody's probably heard of saving. System. System administrative tool for analyzing networks. Released in 1995, April 5th. Dan Farmer. I admit, shamefully, I cannot pronounce then I have to parse that banner to find out if it's the correct version, and then I make the assumption that the security hole must exist because that's SendNow 2.6. So I did three things. The scanner companies count that as three tests, when in fact, is that three tests? No, that's one test. That is one test, one vulnerability. The numbers lie. A more extreme example might be if I have the everyone group. Everybody in here probably knows NT has a problem with the everyone group. Registry keys, a lot of times, have everyone full control. If I have 500 registry keys, and I need to check them to see if they have the everyone group on them, is that 500 tests or one test? Now, no scanner company has been that blatant or that forward, but it's kind of illustrating an example. Everybody thinks they have the best recording. I think all the recording sucks. First of all, when you see a report from one of these scanners that has a big pie chart of green, yellow, and red run, what does that mean? Because you have a red vulnerability, does that mean you have a serious vulnerability? Is that vulnerability on your main PDC? What is on the box that has that vulnerability? You have unknown attackers with unknown motives going after unknown vulnerabilities in your network. They have unknown, they're going after unknown assets in your network. I don't know what Joe Random Hacker values my data as. I might think I have a gold mine in this box when in fact, over here there's just some little program, and for some reason somebody values that a whole lot more. There's no way to enumerate risk with a security scanner, but when you see a report on one of these things, you're not looking at reality. The only thing they can really tell you is a line item list of things that they have found. How important those things are to fix to you is your call. The scanner can't do that for you. And this is a really big lie. If you ever hear a scanner company say that they can enforce your policy, or even using the word policy, yeah, that's wrong. First of all, security policy is very complex and much larger than the scope of a security scanner. How many here have a security policy? A real security policy? So, when you have a security policy, did that affect the way you set up your firewall? Did that affect how you set up your ACL list or your Cisco router? Did the scanner, can the scanner empirically test that? Of course not. It doesn't do that. Now, I have to bow down a little bit. I don't think that the scanner companies have ever claimed that they can fix everything. But sometimes you think, you get the impression they're trying to project security nirvana, which is not what they not where they're going to take you. So that's the crux of my talk. The key statement here, if you leave with one thing today, remember this. It is 100% possible that after your scan, you catch all the bugs that it's told you, you are no more secure than when you started. Why? Well, let's talk about that. My theory is the attack domain is not confined. This is the number of things that a scanner can find. It can find them because a bunch of programmers have been sweating away all day writing checks that theoretically will find these things. But the real world's not like that. Everybody here read bug track? Alright, so how many new bugs are reported every week? define new buffer overflows. How does it do this? It lets you state a set of fields that you know that the application protocol understands. For instance, cgibin/insert random number of capital A here, dot random number of capital A's here, and so forth, and it will continue to increase those buffers until the machine stops responding. Retina will do that. And using Retina, I've already discovered a new buffer overflow in INET info, and it has been released. And it's awesome. Go check it out. Tell you now, there's a root compromise in your network. Right now, every one of you has a root buffer overflow that's going to give a remote intruder access to everything in your network, and it exists. So, you're going to go fix it. Okay. So you go, say you leave right now and you fix that root buffer overflow. Well, great. But I'm sorry, I wasn't talking about that one. I'm glad you fixed it. That's a good thing to do. But I was really talking about that root buffer overflow right there on that other machine. So you go and fix that. Well, I'm sorry again. I really wasn't talking about that one either. I'm talking about the one you never fix. It's always there. Now let me ask you this. Can you sleep well at night knowing that there is a root buffer overflow in your network? You kind of have to. The point is you can't remove it, but you can place controls on it. And a security scanner is not about placing controls. It's not about security policy, it's not about redundancy, having backups, it's not about forensics, it's not about fear, uncertainty, and doubt. I mean, I have this program that I run on my network that transmits fake hashes, the hashes that you saw in Eric Schultz's talk this morning, and then I have an IDS that will detect the use of those hashes anywhere. What if a hacker breaks into my network, and, I just sniffed a hash, let me use it. Well, I just found out. I just was alerted. Create fear, uncertainty, and doubt in the mind of a hacker. That's a deterrence. The word audit does not belong in the same paragraph. Once again, this is just what I'm saying. It's not policy stuff we're talking about. I do have to say, you can run a scanner. You can tell, I want the password policy to be, minimum of 8 characters, blah, 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 blah. That's sort of like policy. That's an enforced policy. But it's really what the scanner is doing is managing a configuration for you. And scanners are just starting to do that. In the future, they actually will be more and more policy, or excuse me, audit policy related. Okay. Why are reason is that you should, it's once again the visibility problem. You should have visibility from both sides of the fence. And run those scans off and compare the reports. Some of the things you run into if you're external is if you've got ping turned off and none of your machines will ping, you have to force scan perhaps. The external scanning takes longer. Does everybody here know what a false positive is? It's when the scanner tells you that a vulnerability exists but it doesn't. That's erring to the side of caution. That's good. I'd rather have a false positive than a false negative. school kit. Fedgon has one. And there's some other ones around as well. This is really important. I wanted to give you something cool and a neat GUI code thing. I thought Jeff would be really disappointed if I didn't do something like this. So I, over the weekend, wrote this cool. It's, yes, developed an assembly language for Windows OT. And it does indeed have an OpenGL render view that is a 3D view. It's an automatic scanner that it implements all the tricks that InMap does, but it works on Windows OT. It can do SYN scanning, UDP, ICMP received from ICMP destination port unreachable. Can be a window for people to run anything you've got in your system. If you have a map, The question was about comparative analysis. Do you mean between the products? Yeah, so the question was, is Nessus a lot better, a lot worse, and what costs anywhere? Its coverage is a lot smaller. But then again, it has an open source community supporting it. So I think in time, Nessus will surpass. If people start adopting it, it's an open source project. That's right. For now, it has a small base. The question was, why doesn't my copy of this Mobius work? I have stopped answering those emails. Forward your questions to my